Hi, I'm Tara Hitchcock, and you're watching Harkins Theaters Behind the Screens. Get ready for award season cast of One Night in Miami. This is Regina King's directorial debut, a fictionalized evening back in 1964 when Cassius Clay, Malcolm X, NFL great Jim Brown, and Sam Cooke all gathered together to talk about everything from race to success and their role in all of it. I'll be honest, it's hard to pick a favorite performance out of this group. Fortunately, we didn't have to. Harkins Behind the Screens zoomed with the whole cast.
I'm the new heavyweight champion of the world, and I don't even have a scratch on my face.
I love hearing you talk about your son and how when it came to these four icons, you see your uncle, you see a father, you see a son. Which man did you see more of your son in?
Probably Cassius, because the youth and the sensitivity, but still his unapologetic pride for being a Black man.
You mean no one else is coming?
If you could invite a fifth and maybe a woman, who would that have been?
Oh, wow. That's a tough one. You know what's interesting? Everything that I do, whether it's an actor or director, I always put together a playlist of music that inspires the character or inspires me with the story. Pretty much all of Nina Simone was in that playlist. So I'll go with Nina Simone.
Man, that group, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, or actually, you know what? Sidney Poitier, my favorite actor of all time. I would love to have him in there.
Ooh, if I could invite a fifth, maybe like the Godfather of Soul, you know, maybe James Brown in that room. That might have been right. You know, that would have been. Yep. And James would have been on my side. James would have been looking for the party. Right. Believe me, he would have been looking for the party. Unlike Malcolm.
After the fight, we're all coming back here for the champs victory party.
I know it was a lifelong dream of yours. Where do you start when you're portraying someone like him?
You got to build it from the ground up. You know, I mean, there's something, some people said I had some similarities in terms of like favoring him a little bit, but the truth is I didn't walk around at the same size as him. I didn't have the accent. So I had to find a dialect coach. I'm not a boxer. I had to find a boxing coach. I had to find a physique trainer and really just, you know, dedicate my whole life and all my time to immersing myself in that role.
Don't you think, in addition to all the things that we've kind of come to recognize him, just his sense of humor, which, by the way, he never lost, and his optimism in spite of everything he had been through. What of you did you see in him?
I think the biggest correlation between the two of us is just our faith. You know, he's a Muslim and I'm a Christian, but just his dedication to his faith, his willingness to be bold, you know, I think that's something that for me, I learned a lot from. And that was powerful.
Out of all, you know, it's hard to pick a favorite when it comes to these performances. And I know it's going to be real interesting come awards time because everybody, I mean, you guys are all incredible. But just out of curiosity, who's the prettiest?
Why am I so pretty?
Oh, it's not even close. It's definitely me. I mean, I don't want to brag too much, but yeah, I don't think that's a question.
I don't think none of them are pretty. None of them. We're all ugly.
That is definitely not the case.
Yeah. Give him an autograph, Jim.
Actually, Mr. Cook.
What of you did you see in Jim Brown?
His fortitude when it came to his drive for his agenda, you know, wanting to understand the necessity to spread the education when it came to economics within the culture and understanding how to grab onto his purpose, grab a hold of his own narrative and control that and move forward. That's what I do in my career. And that's what I've had to continue doing to get further. And then that's where I felt the most synergy when it came to researching Mr. Brown and what he accomplished.
I think what's so great, I mean, there's so many great things about this movie, but when you hear all these different perspectives, you know, and some of them are very different and you're like, oh, I kind of side with him. Oh, wait a minute. That was a good point. Like you're kind of constantly changing your perspective a little bit, even though there were times where I thought, oh, Sam Cooke is out of here in about 2 seconds flat. And he stayed longer than I thought. But did this shift your perspective on any of these subjects, kind of having all of this dialogue put together?
Well, for me, my ideas of what the subject matter was were sort of solidified, which is what drew me to this film in the first place, because the conversation they had in this film is a conversation that's very familiar to me. And I'm very involved in activism, you know, and you know, my moves on a regular basis have a lot to do, even my professional moves have a lot to do with going up against the things that held me back when I was coming up and still try to hold me back today. So for me, this was all very familiar territory, and it only fortified my belief in what it is I'm trying to do, because I already aligned my beliefs with what was going on in the film.
So what's on the agenda, Malcolm?
Well, I thought this would be a wonderful chance for us to reflect.
Kingsley, 3 minutes just does not do your performance justice. I read that you said Mark Rylance kind of taught you to never read reviews. I think you might want to start for this one.
He did say that. It's you know, it's hard to follow, but it was. I remember when he said that. Yeah.
What of you? Did you see in Malcolm?
I saw a huge heartbeat of vulnerability and the essence of the text. When I first read this film, it was like, this is really different and interesting, and it was really clear that whoever was going to play Malcolm needed to understand that emotional undercurrent, that sort of, that his vulnerability and the humanity of him was what was, you know, at the center of this. So yeah, I feel like that was really clear just from Kemp's words, that this was the four men in this room and the conversation and the love and the joy and the friendship between them was going to be the part that was essential.
Like our young brother said, there's no denying that greater forces were at work.
How did you not get the Barack and the Malcolm X, you know, dialect confused or cadence or pacing when you were shooting both, I think at the same time?
I had three dialect coaches. They don't know about it. I was cheating on all of them at the same time, but I like to have three because they all, you know, offer something different and have a different perspective and a way in. And then I add my take on all of that. So I'm a little bit obsessed with dialect because I think, you know, 10 years ago when I first came to LA, I had some really bad experiences of like messing it up and having some really rubbish audition. So my relationship with dialect has been a bit obsessive ever since then. And like I spend probably 10 times as much time as I need to on it just in case, you know, I don't want to mess it up. So, you know, it was just a lot of technical work and great people around who were able to show me the ways in and out.
Well, it's a beautiful relationship, you and the obsession with dialect at work. I know you said you learned patience by directing. I hope it has carried through to this new year. As we enter it, we all need a little bit of patience. And just congratulations, Regina. I'm just dazzled.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Your brothers could move mountains without lifting a finger.
It's probably one of the best things I've seen in the past year, and you get to experience one night in Miami at a Harkins Theater. Hey, don't forget to like us on Facebook, Harkins Theaters, for your movie news, promotions, and giveaways. And I know we just had the holidays, but you know what makes a great gift any time of year? The 2021 Harkins Loyalty Cups, available at any Harkins Theater.